If you have a Janome MC9450 and you've been wondering how to use the tapering function, you definitely want to watch today's video because I'm going to show you how to use it. Hi, I'm Kim from Chatterbox Quilts, and if you are not yet a subscriber to my YouTube channel, stop right now and click that subscribe button, and be sure to hit the bell as well so you'll get notifications the next time I have a new video. One of the new features on the Janome MC9450 is the tapering function. Now, there are only certain decorative stitches where you can use this tapering function, but it's quite easy to figure that out because as soon as you click on the tapering function button, it'll tell you, or really show you, the decorative stitches that you can use. So let's take a closer look at the screen so I can walk you through how to get that all set up before you actually start stitching with it. Okay, before I get ahead of myself and you're wondering what the heck is a tapering function, well, you're going to see it, but basically what it is some of the decorative stitches on the Janome MC9450, you can take them and you can make them go narrower down on different angles. It's hard to explain to you in words. That's why I want to show you how to set up on the machine and then actually do some sewing and show you what it looks like. But once you understand what it can do, I know you're going to have lots of uses for it. So come on over to the machine, I'll show you how to get it all set up. So let's take a closer look at the tapering function and the different screens that are associated with it. If you're looking in your manual, you'll find information about this on page 75. And remember, only certain decorative stitches can be used with the tapering function. So let's find out what those are. So this is the tapering function button. So when you push on it, you get a different screen. Now, there are 40 stitches you can use the tapering feature with, and there are two ways to get to those stitches. One is by using the arrows along the bottom, and you're probably familiar with doing that already. You see we move along. So there are actually 5 groups of 8 stitches each. And you can see as we move along that my page number changes and it'll just cycle back to page 1 when you've run through all those 40 stitches. So that's one way of getting to the various stitches, and of course you can just select them when you're in those different screens. There's another way of getting to those stitches as well, and that is by hitting this little button up here. So that is your stitch reference key. And it's going to show those groups again. It actually has numbers for them. So group 1 is these 8 stitches, group 2 is the ones here, etc. And again, to go to the last 2 groups, you just use your arrow key. We're going to cycle back around again. So either way, whatever works best for you. I suppose when you use this one here, you get to see a few more of the stitches all at once. But otherwise, everything works just the same way. Now, let's go in a little further. If we go in here and we pick one of these designs, let's say I go and look at a satin stitch type design, you can see we've got a group of stitches here. And then there's all kinds of other things on the screen, right? Sometimes these screens can look really intimidating, but let's talk about them so they're not so intimidating. This here is called your edit box, and it's clickable. So when I click on it, it takes me in here. Now, what is this? Well, this little diagram here shows me what the beginning of your stitch is like, what the tapering is like at that side of your stitch. This is your stitch body, and that is the end of your stitch. So right now we're looking at a 60 degree start. This is what my main stitch body looks like, and that's my end, okay? It gives you a preview. You don't really even need to go in there because you can see your preview here, and quite frankly, I think you've got a better view of what your stitch is going to do by looking at your edit box. All right, then you have some more things down here. What else do we have? Well, this looks kind of familiar. So this is your stitch width, so you can adjust your stitch width and length. Of course, it was at 9, which is the highest it'll go. And then you've also got your stitch width, sorry, length. And this is as far down as it'll go as 0.4. So when I said satin stitch like, it's because I can't get it to be really, really dense. It'll be dense enough, but it's not as dense as what you might want your satin stitch to be. So just to let you know about that. Also, there's, see that little preview again here, right? There are some little buttons here. Look like little eyes staring at you, sort of, right? And what are these? And you can see they're clickable. They toggle back and forth. Well, they look like something else on your sewing machine. They look like your lock stitch on your sewing machine. That's exactly what they are. So you can choose to have your stitches at the beginning be locked and your stitches at the end be locked or not. So they say they just toggle on and off. So when they are yellow, they are active. In other words, the machine will sew a lock stitch at the beginning. And when that one's yellow, it'll sew it at the end. Now, by default, they are set to this. The machine will
So a lock stitch at the beginning and at the end after it's finished the stitch pattern. I should say the stitch pattern is not just one stitch. It's gone through the whole thing. And you may wonder, why would I not want to have it lock, you know, at the beginning and the end? Well, we're going to see how you can use these tapering stitches. And what happens is if you wanted to go around a square, for example, let's just say you were going along here and you came to the end, and it's going to be clickable story about that, but we're going to go back. If you come to the end of your line there and you're at your corner and you want to keep going down the next and around, 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 you don't want to necessarily have to lock your stitches here because you're just turning the corner and continuing on. So in that case, I would have my beginning stitch locked, my first start, and I would take this off so it doesn't do that at the end when I come to the first corner. And then when I go around the corner, I don't need to lock my beginning stitch, so I take that off, and then I'd have both of them off until I came up to the very end again, and then I'd want to put my lock stitch back on again. Okay, if it sounds a little confusing, don't be confused. I'm going to show you how we're actually going to go through and use this function, and that'll make a little more sense then, probably. What else do we have here? Well, we have another little button, and oh my goodness, look at the choices here. Okay, this is where the fun really begins. Okay, these are your different angles that you can have at the beginning and at the end of your decorative stitch, okay? These ones here, all these choices here, are for the angles that you can choose to have at the beginning of your decorative stitch. And the cool thing is, when I choose them, you notice that the stitch in my edit box changes accordingly, okay? And sometimes you hear my needle move as well, okay? Depending on where it's going to start, it has to move over there. Or if you don't want it on at all, you can just have it off. So you've got lots of choices and combinations here. So all the angles you see up here are for the tapering at the beginning of your stitch. The ones down below are, can you guess? The tapering at the end when it stops. Okay, so you've got 30 degree at the beginning and at the end. You'll notice that there's two of them, right? So you can have the 30 degree going one direction or going in the other direction. So you have some different opportunities here. Some of them, like with the 60 degree angle, I'm gonna go back to the top, might be easier for you to see. The 60 degree angle, you can have it in different ways, in the middle or at either side. That's kind of interesting too. So a lot of different opportunities here to make some interesting looks. And some of these, like the 45, is gonna be a favorite, I'm sure, because it's going to be like a miter, okay? And so again, depending on which way you want that miter to go, you can just make those choices. All right, so that's kind of obvious, and I like how the stitch moves around the edit box. You can actually see what it's going to do, but there's more. So there's this area in here. Now, what does this mean? Okay, you have a couple of choices as to how long you want your stitch to be as far as how long it's going to stitch along the edge of your fabric for, or wherever it's going to be on your fabric. So if this little box looks like an infinity symbol, sort of, that says the machine is going to keep sewing, 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 sewing until you hit your lock stitch button, at which point in time it's going to start its tapering. Okay, and I'm going to talk about that in a little more as well. But you can choose, if you want, to say, I want to have, and I'm going to use this here, there's two methods of doing this, but I'm going to use this here with the plus here. Notice what's happening in my edit box. I can choose to have the body of my stitch be 7 lengths or 8 lengths or 9 lengths or whatever. And as you see, the body is getting longer. It's not like it's tapering longer, just the body of the stitch is getting longer before it comes to the tapering. So if you chose 9, for example, the machine would just stitch along until it came to 9, it would taper down, and it would, if you had it chosen, you would have the stitch lock off at the end. So you wouldn't have to tell it, I want you to stop now. It's going to stop after 9 repetitions of the stitch body. Okay, I think that's probably not going to be what most of us do, because I think it's going to be hard to figure out how long that's going to be unless you do a trial stitch first, I guess. You could do that. I think it might be easier to just leave it on infinity and you push the lock stitch button when you want it to stop its the pattern body, to finish off the pattern body and then start tapering. But I did tell you there's two ways of doing that, didn't I? If you wanted to have a certain number of, let's say 3, of the body of the stitch out, you could do it, and you see it's carried it over into here. You could do it with this sort of little calculator. Looks like a little calculator, but it's carried the 3 over because that's what I'd chosen already. But I could have it, you know, 5 or 6 or whatever, 56. It's going to carry that on. You know, so there's a clear button there, so it'll put how many I want in there. Okay, so two ways of doing that. But like I say, if you have it on infinity, it just keeps stitching until you push the lock stitch button, and then it's going to finish the body of the stitch and then start tapering. Okay, few more little things here. As you know, DFT for your default stitch, so if I want to change everything back to the way this was originally, I could push that. Then you have this, which looks like a butterfly, but it's a vertical mirroring option. So if I wanted to have it go the other way, you notice the tapering is going another direction now, you could do that. If you want to keep that stitch, you set up the tapering, you've got a certain number of repetitions of the pattern body and you want to keep it, you can certainly do that. Now I've set up a file called taper, but you would just put it in wherever you wanted to. You could create a new folder if you wanted to. You could put it on your machine storage, which is what I've done, or on a USB stick if you wanted to. Okay, because once you've got those set up, like I said, if you're using, let's say, the 45, you may want to use that a lot. You may want to save it, and it saves you having to recreate it all over again. So when you've got your stitch set up the way you want it to, you click OK, as usual. Now, one thing you'll notice up here, we've got that vertical mirroring button up here as well. Because I hit it on the other screen, it's remembered and kept it there. So you could do it in that place as well. All right. So I think that's most of what you can do with the tapering function as far as the different choices you have with it. Again, only those stitches you see in there are ones you can use it with. If you bring in any created stitches from Stitch Composer, you wouldn't be able to use it on there either. I think the stitches they've chosen will be quite handy, and I think they've probably chosen ones that will work well to have that tapering occur. All right, so that's most of what you can do in this area, but now you probably want to see how it stitches out, right? So we're going to show you how to do that next, and I've got a little bit more information and suggestions on how to work best with the tapering function too at that time. They make really nice decorative stitches to go around applique shapes. They're really nice to make a frame. So if you were doing some fussy cutting, let's say, and you had a piece pattern and maybe you have a square or a triangle in the middle with that fussy cut fabric in the middle, it would be really nice to go around it and create a frame around it. You can see this little guy here, looks like a little frame. And on this one, I used a 45 degree angle, and you can see how nicely that worked out. If it didn't work out very well, it was probably operator error, okay? But you really do need to practice with these. Another thing I want to show you here is just to show you what the machine does. Let me just get this here. I want to show you this here. This looks a bit strange. Now, this is not something I intentionally wanted to do, but I wanted to show you this so you understand how the machine works. I was going through, I started on this side and I'm going up into my stitch, and then I went, you know what? I want to make the stitch wider. So I stopped, I had my needle down in my fabric, and I changed my stitch width and made it wider. And what happens when you do that is the machine thinks, oh, we're changing now, we're going into something totally different, we need to start all over again, which it does. So it starts its tapering again, as if it's right at the beginning. It thinks it's at the beginning, and then we go into that. And then I go, oh, I want to make my stitch width narrower. And the machine goes, oh, we're doing something new again. Let's start all over. So that's what it does. So just to let you know, once you start stitching, if you haven't actually finished that pattern length and had it taper and stop, if you decide partway through you want to make some changes, the machine's going to say, we're starting all over again. So you're going to get something like this. So just keep that in mind when you're stitching. So I'm going to show you how to use stitch number 26 to go around this square. I've already set it up with a 45 degree angle at the beginning and at the end of the stitch. I've got my fabric. I've got two pieces of interfacing behind, so that will give it the stability it needs for this type of stitch. As far as my stitch design, as I said, I already had it set up, so this is what it looks like. I'm going to lock my stitches at the beginning, but I don't want to lock them at the end because I'm coming up to a corner, and then I'm going to turn the corner and keep going. So when I get to the corner and I stop, I don't need the stitches to lock because I'm continuing on. And before I continue on, I'm actually going to take off the beginning lock as well because we're continuing on. But to start, of course, you always want to have your stitches locked. So I'm all set up, ready to go, and I'm going to stitch down here. I'm going to do my lock stitch and hope that I hit that corner pretty close on. Let's see how I do. Oh, not too bad at all. So that's what you can see. So you can see the taper at the beginning there. Okay, so now I'm turning 90 degrees, right? I'm turning around the corner. So what I'm trying to do here to keep myself as straight as I can is to use the edge of my pressure foot. It's not going to go, it's not that wide a stitch, so it's not going to go right to the edge. But I'm trying to line up the inner edge of my pressure foot to be on the same line as the edge of my fabric here. I can use either one, really. This one's a little closer. So that's what I'm trying to do to see how I do coming around the corner. Now, there's a couple things my machine has done now. It stopped, obviously, and it didn't lock off my stitches because I told it not to because we're continuing stitching along. But I now have a message on my screen. So the message on my screen, it's like, warning, warning, okay. It's done 9 pattern repeats. It tells me that now. Should I need to know that? It might come in handy. And it wants to know, do I want to do the same size or a different size? You've seen this come up before, I'm sure, in other situations. And in this particular situation, I'm going to say okay, because I've got a square here, so all sides, theoretically, should be the same length. So I'm going to go okay. So what that's going to do is, it's going to tell my machine, I'm going to stitch exactly the same length I already did, and then I'm going to stop. So I don't have to stop it this time. So that's going to be really handy. The other thing I want to do here is I want to take off my locking of the stitches at the beginning because I don't need to do that. We are just continuing along. So now I'll go back and we're going to do the second side. So hopefully if I've got my foot lined up the way I should pretty much meet that miter there with my first stitches as it tapers into the regular stitch. Let's see. Okay, so let's see how we did here. Let me move this around so you can see it hopefully a little bit better. There's my miter. There's where it was joining up there. It looks pretty darn good. I think it's better than I would do on my own, that's for sure. So now I just need to go around 2 more sides, and it's going to continue doing the same length for me. So I'm just going to do the second side, come around heading towards home, as it were, and you can take a look then and see how well we do to meet up with that beginning taper. Okay, so there we go. It didn't quite meet up at the end. That's probably more my fault than the machine's, because look at how nice the other ones did. Those miters look great in the corner. So this is what the square looks like when it's all stitched out. So the miters worked really, really well. There's one that didn't work as well, and I think that was more operator error, that I was just had a bit of a different angle coming into the corner there. But the rest worked very, very well. So it worked really nice as a frame for that particular piece of applique. So that's how the tapering function on the Janome MC9450 works. So why don't you give it a try? I'm sure you're going to have lots of fun with it and find lots of uses for it as well. If you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and share it with your quilting friends.